So, Senator, how you doing, Bill? It's all good. So Senator Jane Diaz is serving her fourth term as Massachusetts Senator, and she's the first Latina elected to the Senate. Joint Committee on Education, so something that you guys all care about. Member of the Joint Committee on Children and Families, and she's a tireless advocate for high-quality education and increasing opportunities for Massachusetts' underserved population. She was born in Newton. We got some Newton folks there. Born in Boston, schooled in Newton. So we got, okay, the Boston folks can give her love, and the Newton folks can give her love. She was a teacher in Boston Public Schools. And so one fact before we give the floor to her. Her father, who immigrated to the U.S. from Costa Rica, was America's first Latino astronaut.
Thank you. But that's entry level civic engagement. And I hope that you're beyond that level of basics at this point, and that you're here at Generation Citizen because you're ready for more. So I'm going to talk about some advanced level civic engagement today, because as I said, you don't get your lifetime badge just for voting. So beyond voting, and even beyond new things like writing or emailing or tweeting your elected officials, or even writing a letter to the editor to influence your neighbors, what are some of the versions of civic engagement that you know about, that you've seen, maybe that you've been practicing already through your own projects and experiences? And I mean, and I'm asking you a question, even though we're in this big auditorium, I'm curious to know, what are some forms of civic engagement that you guys know about? And
to partake in civil disobedience is not a mindless or
It is a carefully crafted action, executed both with civil pretense and a key understanding of how it will bring about change. I bring up civil disobedience with you as young people because you really are, as young people, the inheritors of a rich American tradition of this form of civic engagement. History shows us that it is often cited young people who have fought most passionately and publicly to reform unjust laws and to push our government to be better. And there are countless examples of young people who have made lasting impact in the changing landscape of politics here in Boston, in Massachusetts as a state, in our country at large. And I'm sure that each of those young people could echo the experience of Gandhi that he so clearly laid out in that quote. So I want to tell you some of these stories because I think these stories are important for you to carry around with you to know what the experience has been like for people who have gone before you. Not as grown-ups, right, once you go through school and get out into the real world, but young people who are living in the real world today. So first, today, Gloria. You guys ever heard of the civil rights sit-in from the 1960s? Yes? Okay, good. That was a movement that was brought to life by young people. We hear about it a lot associated with Dr. Martin Luther King, certainly a pivotal leader, but the movement itself was really brought to life by young people. And on February 1st, 1960, it was four African-American college students who sat down at a lunch counter at the Woolworths in Greensboro, North Carolina, and fled the Apple Church. Their request was refused. And then when they were asked to leave, they simply remained in their seats. And in the 1960s, the South was a world of being ignored for black individuals, from restaurants to bathrooms to public transportation. Today, after decades of progress, we still have a long way to go in raising, in addressing racial inequality and closing achievement gaps. And we see again today, recently, two young people, high school students at Boston Latin. They did it. This was a 17-year-old Maggie Noel and an 18-year-old Kylie Rester Kazoo, and I hope I'm not butchering her last name. I'm sure this happened many times before. They started the Black at BLS movement. And they did that to expose what they experienced as a hostile school climate. And Maggie put it this way when she talked to the New York Times reporter about it. She said, it just felt like what we go through every day was completely disregarded. Disregarded or ignored. And neither Kylie nor Maggie nor the lunch counter protesters, neither of them were okay being ignored. So they moved forward and they fought for something else. Then they laughed. The best anecdote that I have is one that came to mind most immediately for me when I think about someone getting laughed at as they started on the path of working outside the system and doing something that unofficially was a little bit like civil disobedience. With my experience in my first election, I was a young candidate who had never run for anything before, and to start with the state senate race at that stage was a very unlikely endeavor. And a lot of people said, you know, don't you just start with, you know, running for a dog catcher or, you know, city council before you start with the state senate race. And I, to be frank, you know, I know people thought I was going to be free. And they didn't laugh at me to my face, to their credit. But I'm sure that many, many political commentators and sort of, you know, the political chattering class dismissed my candidacy with sort of a bold eye or the verbal equivalent of a pat on the head. And in addition to my youthful inexperience on that campaign, my secret weapon on that campaign was actually two high school students that were campaign interns for me. And they just endlessly knocked on doors and talked to voters on the phone, one after the other after the other, for a whole summer. And people probably smiled and thought they were sweet when they saw them going door to door that whole summer. Those two campaign interns and that, you know, maybe to you 28 years old sounds old, but, you know, we're in the political establishment, that's pretty young. You know, none of us were okay being laughed at, so we just kept plugging away, quietly disobeying the unspoken political order, and organizing for something more. Then they fight you. Civil disobedience requires opposition against pre-existing order. or as high as we want. So for people and institutions that benefit from that order, they're not going to give it up willingly. Malala Yousafzai, she knows that backlash effect well. She was a young woman born in the Swat Valley in Pakistan. And Malala demanded more from her government when the Taliban started attacking girls' schools. At the age of 11, she gave a speech in Peshawar titled, "How Dare the Taliban Take Away My Basic Rights to an Education." After being nominated for the International Children's Peace Prize in 2011 and awarded the Pakistan's National Youth Peace Prize, the Taliban put out a death threat against this very young woman. And October 9, 2013, Malala was shot by a gunman on her way home from school. She was 15 years old. We've seen this pattern across history and across the world. Malala in Pakistan, the then 25-year-old John Lewis, who was bloodied by police brutality during the March on Selma, or violence against the Black Lives Matter protesters at Donald Trump rally, more recently in history. These big steps toward progress are often met with the biggest fight, and young people are no strangers to that. Then you win. If you leave knowing one thing, I hope it will be this. The ultimate form of civil disobedience is to accomplish the thing that society tells you is not possible. College student lunch counter protesters empowered a generation and did a great deal to ignite the civil rights movement, producing some of the greatest civil rights legislation in the history of this nation. Maggie and Kylie ended up drawing local, state, and national media attention to the issue of institutional racism in our schools. They've driven all of us to talk openly and directly, not only about racial inequality at Baltimore, but in our city as a whole. Roseton and Donovan, those two campaign interns that I told you about, they ended up winning me that election by 213 votes. And it was the first time in 16 years that that anyone had unseated an incumbent state senator in Massachusetts. Thanks to those two kids.